Picture this, you've taken one too many puffs. Suddenly your mind starts buzzing in a way that's both exhilarating and, well, a bit confusing. Ever wondered what's actually going on inside up there when you get too high? Turns out that it's way more than just your imagination running wild. Marijuana's got a star player called THC. That's short for tetrahydrocannabinol. And this little chemical throws a wild party in your brain. THC doesn't just tickle your funny bone, it rewires your whole system. Get ready, because we're about to dive deep into the science behind getting too high. From why your brain suddenly craves a whole pizza, to why time seems to stretch and bend, we'll break it all down. Okay, so first thing first, it might sound surprising, but our bodies naturally have a whole system designed to interact with substances similar to THC. It's called the endocannabinoid system, and it's made up of receptors scattered throughout our brains and bodies. Think of these receptors like tiny locks, and our body's own natural cannabinoids, called endocannabinoids, as the key. This system plays a vital role in regulating all sorts of functions, from mood and appetite to sleep and memory. It's all about maintaining a healthy internal balance. THC, the psychoactive ingredient in marijuana, is basically a copycat. It mimics our endocannabinoids, but in a much stronger, less regulated way. When we get high, THC floods those receptors and throws the entire finely tuned endocannabinoid system out of whack. The disruption is why marijuana can have such wide-ranging effects on the brain and body. It's not about creating something new, but rather taking our existing internal systems and cranking them into overdrive, or sometimes shutting them down altogether. Understanding the endocannabinoid system is crucial to understanding why getting high is more than just a feeling. It's a full-on chemical hijacking with a whole range of consequences. So now that we got the biological foundation, let's dive into how THC directly targets specific brain regions. Now here's where things get really interesting. THC, the main psychoactive ingredient in marijuana, is a molecular copycat. It has a similar structure to our body's own endocannabinoids, those natural chemicals that work with the endocannabinoid system we discussed earlier. The sneaky similarity lets THC fool our brain's receptors. Instead of a gentle interaction, it's like a stampede. THC floods the receptors, sending signals that are way more intense than our bodies are used to. This overstimulation is what throws our delicately balanced systems completely out of whack. Imagine those receptors like volume knobs that usually operate on the scale of 1 to 10. THC comes in and cranks all those knobs way past 10, blasting signals that our brains simply aren't designed to handle. The result? The wide range of effects we associate with being high. It's not just about the euphoria, it's about disrupting the brain's normal communication in areas that control everything from memory to decision making. The amount of THC matters too. A little might subtly turn up the volume, while a lot is a full-on sensory overload for our internal systems. This is why the experience of being high can feel so different depending on the dose. Now, the brain's a pretty complex organ. Let's pinpoint the main areas of the brain that THC messes with. First up, the hippocampus. Picture your hippocampus as your brain's personal librarian. It files away any new information and helps you recall the details later. THC throws a wild party in the library. Imagine books flying off the shelves and index cards scattered everywhere. That's what happens to your short-term memory when you're high. Try to hold a conversation. If you're a tad too high, good luck remembering what was said 2 minutes ago. The hippocampus isn't just about the present, it's critical for making new memories that stick. When THC disrupts the process, it's like hitting save as and accidentally deleting the file. That awesome idea that you had for a song while you were high? Poof. Gone by morning. The hippocampus also acts like our brain's GPS. It helps us remember places and how to get around. THC scrambles the signal. Suddenly, familiar streets seem confusing, or you're completely blank on where you parked your car. It's not just forgetfulness, it's getting lost in your own neighborhood. While we're on the topic of the hippocampus, let's talk about time. While high, minutes can feel like hours, and a whole evening can fly by in a flash. This is because the hippocampus plays a role in our perception of time, and THC seriously messes with its internal clock. Alright, so we talked about the hippocampus. Now let's shift our attention to another part of the brain that THC affects, the prefrontal cortex. Imagine your prefrontal cortex as the wise CEO of your brain. It's the executive decision maker. It's responsible for planning, reasoning, and that little voice that tells you maybe eating a whole tub of ice cream is not the best idea. Well, THC stages a hostile takeover in the boardroom. Suddenly, impulses rule and good judgment takes a vacation. That sudden feeling of invincibility when high? That's your prefrontal cortex taking a nap. Decisions that would normally make you pause, like texting your ex or taking a dare, might seem strangely appealing. THC weakens the brakes on risky behavior that your sober brain would have stopped. The prefrontal cortex is also a super fast processor, juggling multiple thoughts all at once. THC throws a wrench in the works. Complex tasks like following a conversation or reacting quickly become way harder. Suddenly, even simple choices can feel overwhelming. Here's a tricky one. Some people swear getting high unlocks their creativity. While THC can loosen up your inhibitions, if used in excess, it can actually muddle focus and working memory, key parts of actually bringing those creative ideas to life. Maybe that mind-blowing song that you wrote while high just sounded good at the time. Okay, so what about the realm of your emotions? Enter the next brain area affected by THC, the amygdala. The amygdala is your brain's emotional alarm system, scanning for threats and triggering that fight-or-flight response. THC fiddles with the sensitivity dial, making it hyperactive and sometimes misreading totally harmless situations as danger zones. For some people, THC can initially promote a sense of relaxation and well-being. But the amygdala is a fickle beast. When overstimulated, that chill vibe can quickly switch to a sense of unease or paranoia, even if there's no logical reason for it. Why do some people get paranoid while high, while others feel relaxed? It's not fully understood, but the amygdala plays a huge role. Factors like predisposition to anxiety, the amount of THC, and the setting all influence how the amygdala reacts. The amygdala is central to how we perceive social cues. THC can distort this perception. A casual glance from a stranger might suddenly feel menacing, or a joke might be misinterpreted as an insult. This can make social situations feel way more stressful when high. Now, it's not just about brain regions. The THC also targets neurotransmitters, the messengers between your brain cells. It boosts dopamine, the feel-good chemical, hence the euphoria. But it also messes with the others too, affecting everything from how we perceive time to how sensitive we are to sounds. Picture your brain as a vast communication network. Neurotransmitters are the chemical couriers carrying vital messages between brain cells. When THC enters the picture, it throws the entire system into disarray, causing misfires and mayhem. Dopamine's the neurotransmitter associated with reward and motivation. When we experience something pleasurable, dopamine levels surge, giving us a sense of satisfaction. THC artificially boosts dopamine way beyond normal levels, creating the intense euphoria associated with being high. However, this also means the crash can be severe, leaving you feeling depleted and low when the effects wear off. And with long-term THC use, the dopamine system can actually become blunted. The next neurotransmitter affected by THC, glutamate. This one is the brain's primary workhorse, exciting neurons and making them fire off signals. It's crucial for learning, memory, and overall brain function. However, THC leads to an overproduction of glutamate, throwing your brain into overdrive. Suddenly, thoughts race, your senses feel heightened, and sometimes anxiety can surge as a result of hyperactivity. While glutamate surges, the inhibitory neurotransmitter GABA, or GABA, takes a break. GABA is the yin to glutamate's yang. It's the brain's calming force responsible for reducing anxiety and promoting relaxation. Think of GABA as the brakes on a speeding car. THC sabotages GABA's ability to do its job. This explains why it can be difficult to unwind or quiet your racing thoughts when you're too high. Then there's serotonin. Serotonin plays a huge role in regulating mood, sleep, and appetite. It's our natural happiness booster. While the immediate effects of THC can feel positive, there is evidence that in the long term, THC may disrupt serotonin production and signaling. This might play a role in why some people experience irritability, low mood, or even depression after the high subsides. Keep in mind, the relationship between THC and our brain chemistry is incredibly complex. THC doesn't just mess with the big players like dopamine and GABA. It also impacts other neurotransmitters like acetylcholine, which is essential for memory, and norepinephrine, which controls alertness and focus. The intricate web of effects is why everyone's experience with being too high can be so unique. So, to recap, can smoking a joint give you the next philosophical breakthrough or unlock a hidden artistic genius within you? Well, maybe, but it's complicated. THC definitely loosens up your thinking, making you less likely to judge your own ideas. This can be great for brainstorming or free association, but here is the catch. THC also messes with focus, working memory, and the ability to actually execute your ideas. So you might have a brilliant flash of inspiration, then spend the next hour trying to remember what it was. Now there are some individual differences to keep in mind. For instance, ever notice how some of your friends practically melt into the couch after getting high, while others suddenly have an unstoppable urge to reorganize their closets? Turns out that weed can have totally opposite effects when it comes to energy levels. This is partly due to the different strains of marijuana. Indicas are famous for their mellow, sleepy vibes, while sativas often have a more uplifting, energizing quality. It all depends on the specific mix of chemicals with each strain. Dose plays a big role too. A little bit might give you a slight buzz, but overdo it and you might be glued to your couch for hours. Finally, our bodies process THC a little bit differently, so what makes one person feel wired could leave their friend ready for a nap. Why do some people feel chill and giggly while high when others get paranoid? Think of your body as a unique party for THC. Genetics plays a huge role, kinda like how some people can handle their liquor while others get tipsy after one drink. The more often you get high, the more tolerance your body builds up, meaning you need to get a higher dose to achieve the same effect as before. Setting and mindset also make a massive difference too. Getting high at a chill hangout with your friends is a whole different vibe compared to getting high before a stressful job interview. Now, edibles are a whole different beast. When you eat something infused with THC, hold on tight. Instead of hitting your bloodstream quickly like with smoking, edibles have to go on a long journey through your digestive system. This means there's usually a delay before you'll feel anything, and then wham, everything kicks in all at once, often way stronger. Top of that, your liver breaks down the THC from edibles differently, creating a more potent chemical that sticks around your system for longer. This is why many rookie edible experiences end with someone way higher than they bargained for. The takeaway? Dosing with weed, especially for beginners, is all about starting low and going slow. This holds doubly true for edibles. Pay attention to how your body uniquely reacts, not just what worked for your friend. There's no single normal high, so focus on safety and knowing your limits. Okay, we've talked about brains, but being too high doesn't just mess with your mind. It throws your whole body a curveball too. Let's break down the weirdness that happens when you get too high. First up, the munchies. Ever get high and suddenly feel like you could devour a whole pizza or two plus dessert? That's not just your willpower failing. THC goes haywire with your appetite hormones. It flips the I'm full switch off and it tricks your brain into starvation mode, even if you've just ate. No wonder those chips suddenly seem irresistible. Then there are those bloodshot red eyes, the classic giveaway that you've been hanging out with Mary Jane. Why does that happen? Well, THC lowers your blood pressure and dilates your blood vessels in your eyes, making them appear redder. It can also dry your eyes out, adding irritation. Pro tip, eye drops are your friend. THC is also like a prankster messing with your body's GPS. Coordination can become quite difficult under the effects of too much weed. Suddenly, walking in a straight line seems hard, and catching a ball feels impossible. Your reaction time slows down and your sense of balance gets wonky. This is why attempting anything even slightly athletic while high is generally a recipe for clumsy disaster. Best captured on video for later laughs, of course. Alright, so we've covered the immediate craziness of getting too high. What about the long-term impacts? It's important to remember frequent marijuana use can have lasting effects, especially for young people, so let's get into it. First off, let's talk about developing brains. Teenage brains are construction zones. They're still wiring up important connections, especially for things like decision-making and impulse control. THC throws a wrench into the works. Studies suggest it could change how teen brains develop, potentially affecting learning and memory, and even lowering your IQ over time. Basically, weed is a detour sign on the route to a fully grown-up brain. Forget where you put your keys while high? That's normal. However, some research indicates heavy long-term marijuana use might make memory problems stick around, even after you sobered up. It's still being debated, but the possibility is definitely something to consider if you're blazing all day every day. THC can also wreak a bit of havoc on the mental health landscape. Sure, we know weed can mess with your mood in the moment. However, for some people, chronic use increases the risk of developing long-term anxiety or depression. Even more concerning, if you're predisposed to mental illnesses like schizophrenia, frequent marijuana use can potentially trigger these conditions. Not for everyone, but the risk is real. This stuff isn't meant to scare you. It's about being informed. Everyone's body is different, and more research is needed for definitive answers. But especially for young folks, understanding the potential long-term impacts of getting high is responsible. Now, let's clear the smoke around some persistent weed-related myths. These aren't just opinions, but scientific facts, so you can make informed choices. Let's start with weed myth number one. Weed is harmless. While marijuana is less likely to lead to a fatal overdose compared to some other drugs, it doesn't mean it isn't without its risks. Getting too high can lead to accidents, poor judgment calls with lasting consequences, and potential for anxiety or paranoia spirals. The long-term effects, especially on developing brains, are still being studied. But research suggests potential impacts on memory, learning, and even IQ. Harmless? Not so fast. Next, myth number two. You can't get addicted to marijuana. While the addictive potential of marijuana may be less compared to substances like opioids or nicotine, addiction is definitely a risk factor. Studies show that roughly 9% of users become dependent, and this number jumps with those who start using during their adolescent years. Addiction means experiencing withdrawal symptoms when you stop, continued use despite negative consequences, and losing control over how much or how often you consume. Marijuana myth number three, marijuana is a gateway drug. This one is complex. The majority of marijuana users won't go on to use harder drugs. However, a significant body of research shows a correlation. Those who start using marijuana, particularly as teenagers, are statistically more likely to experiment with other substances later in life. It's not about guaranteeing a progression, but rather acknowledging that there is an increased risk. Next up, myth 4. Driving high is no biggie. This one is absolutely wrong. THC messes with your coordination, your ability to judge distances, and it slows your reaction time. Even if you feel okay to drive, studies consistently show that marijuana use significantly impairs the skills needed to be safe behind the wheel. Buzzed driving is drunk driving, and the number of accidents linked to cannabis use are on the rise. Finally, we have myth number 5, CBD is just like THC. Wrong again. CBD, or cannabidiol, is another key compound found in the cannabis plant, but it does not produce the high associated with THC. CBD is gaining a lot of attention for its potential therapeutic benefits, with research exploring its use for conditions like anxiety, pain, and epilepsy. It's important to understand they are not interchangeable and have vastly different effects on your body. Psst, we have a video on this topic if you're interested in taking a deep dive. One important note, myths evolve. It's crucial to stay up to date and question what you see online or hear from friends. Look for reliable sources of information backed by scientific studies, like reputable health organizations or peer-reviewed research publications. Stay informed as you consume. Your choices matter, so base them on facts, not fiction. While we've delved into the potential downsides of getting too high, it's important to note that THC isn't all bad. There's growing research suggesting it could have real medical benefits. Scientists are exploring its potential to treat chronic pain, which might offer a much-needed alternative to addictive opioid painkillers. It's also shown promise in reducing nausea for chemotherapy patients. Even anxiety, although high doses of THC can definitely make it worse, is being studied with the possibility of low controlled doses being helpful. It's important to remember that any medical use of marijuana requires supervision by a doctor and is all about carefully controlled doses. This is a far cry from the recreational use we've been discussing throughout the video. So there you have it. Getting too high isn't just a mind trip, it's a full-blown chemical takeover happening in your brain. Understanding how THC messes with your noggin helps explain those sometimes confusing and not so fun side effects of getting a little too elevated. Did this video blow your mind? Let us know in the comments below, then check out what happens to your brain if you smoke weed for 30 days, or watch this video instead.